the Danzig reverb.
Yes, the double-tracked slap-back echo done naturally.
Welcome to Pod of Thunder.
No studio trickery on that.
Nope, nope. The recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting, brought to you by Blue Microphones. They look great. They sound even better. And guess who it is?
It's my buddy Andy.
That's right. It's your buddy Andy, America's little brother. And as always, I'm joined by...
Bam! Bam!
Oh, oh, stop it. Gnarly Nick the Garlic.
Get out of here.
No baking this week.
No. No, sorry. I hope you guys weren't expecting something.
I'm starting to.
Okay. I'll keep that in mind.
It's been happening pretty regularly lately.
I had nothing new.
That's okay.
It doesn't always have to be new. Go back to the tried and true.
I would say once a month should be. I don't want to put any more pressure on you other than that, but I think once a month is sufficient.
I don't mind doing it.
I'll pitch into it.
It could be every single week as far
Speaking
as
Speaking of which, it's a new month. Is it a Thunder month?
It might as well be.
Oh, let me look at the calendar.
It just occurred to me, we're recording before the new month, but this is coming out at the new month.
Well, let's see. Has it been a year already? My goodness.
Look at that. Oh, my gosh. You open up the calendar, and that's what it plays. Well,
what's the event this weekend?
I don't know.
Can you read it? I've got it over here, actually. Yeah, It's the first weekend of the Pot of Thunder month. We're doing the potato donut fry. So join us for that. Date and time and place will be provided shortly.
Potato donut
fry. Stay tuned for details.
Okay, I'm into it. I'm into it. I'm excited. Hey, and over there, guess who's that? That familiar voice next to Nick. Oh, I hope the roof's on tight. Come on now.
I think we need a gunslinger. Somebody tough to tame this town. I think we need a gunslinger. There'll be justice all around.
There he is. Put your hands together for Chris L. He's the breakout star of the podcast medium, and he's here today. So before we get into anything, I want to go back to last week because we have a little bit of cleanup from last week. Mm. I guess. I don't know. That's what I'm going to call it. So last week we mentioned that the Charlie Daniels song In America sort of sounded like Iron Maiden on the one riff, just in a different tone.
Yeah.
Well, we've got something for you this week. We've got that section of the song recorded as if by Iron Maiden. Are you ready?
Really?
Yes.
Interesting. Yeah, let's hear it.
Here we go. Tell me that doesn't work.
I think
it does.
It's perfect.
Yeah. I recognized it as soon as it happened.
Perfectly
Although
done
I'd
by.
I never connected those dots before.
Perfectly done by the number 9 combo. Was that the right number?
The number 12.
The number 12 combo, sorry. That's the backing band. For
9's probably not bad either. I just don't know what it is offhand.
Nicardo Jonez's backing band, the number 12 combo, put that together for us. They don't have a lot to do with the quarantine thing going on. Not a lot of gigs. So.
No.
And all dried up.
Yeah. So there you go. That's from last week. So enjoy that. I hope you did. But
now
excellent
work. Now on to new business.
On to new business, yeah. Wild times. Anything happening? Anything, guys? Any odd social encounters you want to discuss before we...
I don't think so.
No. Not really.
People have been... well, at least around me, they've been minding their manners, their P's and Q's the last week or so. So
yeah, I haven't been out.
Nothing ridiculous, thankfully.
Well, good. That's good. It's Pot of Thunder month. It's
maybe that's why.
I think that's it. It's time to behave yourself. It's Pot of Thunder month.
Better,
act like a grown
better
up.
Watch out. Better not cry. It's Pot of Thunder month.
Okay, so it's my turn to pick from the listener submission list. Let's go in the distance before I even
Good.
Look. I'm
Don't do
it.
The rule either, just 50 of them. Let's Keep on going.
Yeah, he'll find nothing on there. He wants to
What's the
analyze.
Record? Beat the record right now, whatever it is. Shoot everything down.
The record was probably 6, and then an outraged listener by the name of Chris Brown came up with the rule, and it was exactly what we needed.
Well, at least he channeled that frustration in a constructive way.
It's not something he normally does. So it's good.
Or other people with that same moniker
don't always
do that.
They're just angry people if they have that first name last name combo. Mm-hmm. Short fuses, quick to resort to violence. Sometimes in the domestic variety,
it happens.
Yeah.
So, Nick.
What do I
crank up the volume and yank off the knob?
I gotta we got it all.
I don't have to tell him twice with that directive.
Stand by. Let's go over to the Bozo Pewter.
Did you ever notice how he gulps for air after he says stand by? It's like this guy is just on the verge of keeling over.
I feel
hot under those lights with that clown makeup on.
Yeah, and all that.
Well, and just
alcohol he consumed.
Exactly, it's just dangerously intoxicated.
I watched a special about that era of the Bozo Show once, and they made a point to say this was not educational television. We weren't going for that.
Was it ever?
No, but they made a point of saying how a lot of other children's shows, they worked in educational, so they said, no, that was not what we did.
That's fine.
Thanks for pointing
it
out.
It was burlesque for children, basically.
As it should have been.
I feel so blessed that of all the times Bozo said something about the Bozo Pewter, that's the clip that I found. That's got to be the best one where he throws it to the Bozo Pewter.
Yeah.
That's just pure luck. That's like winning a lottery.
There aren't many out there.
I found one clip. That's the one, and that's got to be the best
one. Beautiful.
Yeah. So, all right. So we've got 2258.
What?
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah. I'm worried about that number.
This is weird because I sang this song to myself today.
I think it's gotta happen then, right?
Yeah.
Plus, people expect you to just reject songs. I mean, think about that. There's some serendipity going on.
Okay.
Yeah, surprise the listeners for once. Pick the first poll.
For once. Just do
I'm
it
interested.
Right.
I say pick it for no other reason than I want to know why you were singing this song today.
Well, it'll come to light shortly.
I'll bet.
Right. Well, let's turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold. This one's called
Milk.
Off of
Speak English or Die.
By the band
Stormtroopers of Death.
Ow!
Okay. Now we're talking.
Interesting, huh?
We had an Anthrax song before, but we have not had an S.O.D. song.
Now we have one. This is from Joe Patterson. This is in the Joe Patterson section of our list.
God. Is he another
one? Joe Patterson wing of our museum.
Exactly. But his is extremely varied as far as artists. So
let me put this one in. So.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, this song is covered on Attack of the Killer Bees.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Which is
weird.
Not much of a cover, just because it's the same guys.
It's two of the same guys.
Sort of the same guys.
And then
a
different singer and a different bass player. I don't know why you'd do that. And what is it? I think I want to say it's 5 or 6 years later.
Well,
I don't know the backstory why they did that. But
maybe it was an Anthrax song. Who knows?
Maybe.
Or they just wanted to get more exposure from it. Who knows?
Who knows?
It's Benante and Ian, and then who are the other two members of the band?
Billy Milano, a bold, courageous man.
Mm-hmm.
Any relation to Alyssa?
She wishes.
Not
that I'm aware of, but...
Yeah.
I'm not sure which one is
at this point, he's less controversial than she is.
Yeah, no shit, but... Yeah, controversy aside, Alyssa Milano is an attractive woman. I don't think anybody can dispute that from a physical standpoint.
Yeah.
She wears very revealing face masks, so that's, people are into that.
Plunging nose lines, if you will.
I don't know what you guys are talking about.
There was some kind of controversy. It was like crocheted.
Okay.
It's like, that's not protecting anything.
Okay, I gotcha.
Very revealing.
Yes. And the bass player is Danny Lilker, who was the original Anthrax bass player.
Interesting.
And was tossed out by, what was the first Anthrax singer's name? Dan something? No, that Dan was later.
Yeah, I
can't remember. But whoever it was wanted him out. They kicked him out. And then not long after, they kicked out the singer. But too late to bring back Dan Lilker.
So. Well, once you... I assume he was replaced by Frank Bello.
Correct, yeah.
Yeah, when you don't push Frank Bello aside to bring in the guy who was kicked out and made room for him. That's just simply not done.
Yeah.
So he's relegated to S.O.D.
Yep.
Now, shooting from the hip here, isn't the story of S.O.D. that they had a little downtime and Scott Ian just kind of, more or less, he conceived of the whole project, right?
Yeah. Without looking at anything, I'll tell you what I remember from reading what I've read over the years. So the Sergeant D character, which is the character that a lot of the songs are voiced through, maybe is what you'd say.
Is he the narrator?
Yeah.
I guess?
Yeah. So it's supposed to be like I think he's some kind of zombie military man who's like an ultra conservative, whatever it is, but it's a comic book that Scott Ian used to draw and leave like comic strips around and like draw it while, you know, when they were in the studio for these long days, he would draw like funny, offensive things from this guy, right? And then the other part of it was that they had a bunch of leftover riffs that they didn't use for that album. I want to say a Spreading the Disease, I think. That should line up, right?
With around
85,
the same time,
86.
Yeah.
So, and then they did this album in like less than a week, just banged it all out. So that's what it's leftover riffs from an Anthrax recording.
Now, this, not this song in particular, but the first SOD album,
mm-hmm.
several riffs are forever immortalized because they were brilliantly paired with like 19 teens era Felix the Cat cartoons.
Which sounds like it doesn't make sense, but it makes perfect sense.
And those were lead-ins and for Headbangers Ball, mm-hmm. Coming back from commercial kind of a thing.
Really? That was the music to that? I remember the video clips, but...
Yeah. There were, I think...
And then like weird Demolition Derby type of videos and stuff. Yeah. That's what they were using. And it was, I want to say, United Forces and...
Milano Mosh was definitely that was the big one.
Was it Alyssa Milano Mosh? I like to mosh with her, I'll tell you that.
Is she still doing the Atkins commercials?
Who just knows?
Replaced her with Rob Lowe. I don't know.
She's either doing that or stirring up shit on social media.
I think that's pretty much all she does at this point.
Yeah, which is a shame. Sullying her otherwise unassailable image.
Well, we're just handing out that to everybody.
Yeah. Well, I remember in college, one of our buddies had a poster of her on his wall. She was in a New Jersey Devils jersey, nothing else. So it was like, you know, just barely covering the naughty bits, if you will. And she was holding a hockey stick. Hmm. And we always used to bust his balls about it because, like, dude, she's like 14 in this picture.
No, that's
weird. Like, I don't care.
Was she playing a trap style defense?
Not really.
Was she ruining the rest of the wall?
She was more or less like standing in a defenseman's position just before a face off. So.
Okay.
But the running joke was that she was clearly underage and he simply didn't care. In fact, I think he had the poster up more for the Devil's jersey than who was actually in the poster.
Mm.
So.
Interesting.
Yeah, he's Greek. What are you going to say?
They play with a different set of rules.
They do. They they're like the Jones brothers. The usual rules of the universe do not apply to them. Jones brothers and Greeks are absolved from, you know, towing the line with any civilized behavior.
All right. So, this is, what is this track?
How many tracks are on this album?
21.
21.
But there are, there's a 6 second.
Yeah.
A 7, a 5, and a 2 second. So, I don't know how much you want to count those.
Is Momo on this album?
No, that was live.
That was just a live exclusive.
Who the fuck is Momo? Now, so it's really the whole band and like the, all the songs are based on this character. Is that what you're telling me?
I think it's Sergeant D.
I think to some extent, yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's kind of like, stupid, in my opinion.
It's March of the S.O.D. Sergeant D and the S.O.D., first two songs. So there you go. Not everything, though. Like, this song doesn't make any sense with that.
No.
Milk doesn't go with the theme whatsoever. But this is track 12 of 21.
Now, growing up, we had this cassette, a copy of it, and we had the M.O.D., what was the album
The one with
called?
A shark on it.
Yeah.
Didn't it have a shark?
Gross Misconduct.
Gross Misconduct.
We had that album.
Then we also had the S.O.D. Live.
From Budokan.
Which I didn't realize.
Was not.
For 30 years. 32 years. Oh,
was
yeah.
Was not recorded
that's,
at Budokan.
That's not recorded there.
Oh well,
that's made.
That's
up.
That's 1 point for them, I guess.
Yeah, they got me on that one. I think that actually happened during this show. I realized it. We're talking about Cheap Trick, and then it occurred to me. Wait Could a minute, it. They were pulling our leg.
There can't be a club somewhere in the in
maybe that's what it
middle
was.
Middle America yeah. called the Budokan.
Yeah. So anyway, I know Nick's heard this song. I assume, Chris, by what you're saying, you've not heard this stuff.
I wouldn't know it. I mean, maybe I might recognize it from the Headbangers Ball bumpers, but otherwise, no. So why were you singing this song yourself earlier today?
Because we bought some milk, and I was putting it in the refrigerator. 2 gallons.
Good at reason as any.
Yeah.
2 gallons.
Yeah, well, there's
gallons.
One for the kids, one for the wife and I. A what? Skim for us.
No wonder you were singing it. You had
I was
to
really, double fisting.
Yeah,
I was doing some reps on the way to the refrigerator. But that's it. I don't know what else to say about this album. It's sort of, it's almost like a cult classic. I would say
it absolutely is. Yeah,
it's regarded highly for being like the crossover of metal and punk, but it's also silly.
Is this before Guar?
Guar's first album was 85.
So it's really close.
Ooh, wait a minute. Guar's first album was not 85. Guar formed in 85. Guar's first album was 88.
Because this is very Guar-esque in essence, I would say. Not stage show with costumes and things.
No, but I think musically some of it's similar.
Musically, and just the fact that it's over the top,
over the,
offensive,
yeah.
kind of. It's these. This you, they're singing it, but it's this other character.
Yeah, right.
So it's a, you know,
that's, oh, hey,
they scapegoat
hey,
it.
Hey,
that
that's
way.
Like we've talked about on the show. That's how you get, you know, avoid any accountability for stuff. If you're in the movies, you just say I was acting. Why can't you do the same thing in
playing
music?
A character?
I was channeling something else.
That's what I mean. It's kind of around the same time period as this. We had Andrew Dice Clay about to blow up. That's what he always claims he did, right?
Yeah.
I'm playing a character.
Well, that's what who could question it?
That's true.
Nobody questions it, you know, when these TV shows and movies, the people who create them and write them, come up with all manner of depravity. I mean, you watch like Law and Order SVU, and you watch these plots, and it's like whoever wrote this is a sick motherfucker.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, but I'm just channeling somebody else's. No, how do you channel that unless you have these thoughts going through your own head, weirdo?
I agree with that.
Fucking serial killer. on the verge of acting on it, it's like, who writes this shit?
Yeah, you know? I agree. Unless you've actually done it. Like if Andrew Dice Clay.
another guy who it's claimed as a character.
Really?
Jury's out on that.
Are you telling me he doesn't party that hard?
I think he might, but there are people who think he does not.
Mm. Well, he is getting a little bit older. He's been at it for
20
years.
There are people
years.
Who think he's
plus
never
he's,
partied that
plus
hard.
Plus he's a motivational speaker now, isn't he?
Yeah.
Or was he always I think, that? Too?
To some degree, he always was.
Relatively yeah. soon into his career.
Very encouraging individual.
But again, that's, you know, who can question it? Yeah. I mean, of course, look at Andrew Dice Clay. Do you think he walked around looking like that? I mean, come on.
That's what I mean. Did he look like that? Did he do all the things he said constantly? Is that all he did? And they just plucked him out of earth and put him on stage?
Yeah.
Now, that being said, I just said that. What I know about S.O.D., about Billy Milano, was that that's exactly what happened with Billy Milano. He was not a singer. He was like... the wild, crazy skinhead guy that hung out with Scott Ian at concerts. And he's like, you have to be the singer for this thing. And he's like, okay. So that's how he started.
Kind
because
of,
larger than life, wild man kind of guy.
Now, not that I'm that familiar with El Duque or Duce or however it was, but it seemed similar character, right? Similar kind of guy. Billy
know.
Milano, less musical. I would say to
at least early somewhat, on. I don't know yeah. how much that evolved over time.
Yeah, but I mean, it's kind of like really kind of big guy, like just an outrageous kind of character.
Known for fighting, that was his
yeah.
other thing. Like those crazy '80s hardcore shows that you would hear about, where everything was just a fist fight, and like skinheads fighting. Whatever, metal heads and stuff, all those ridiculous scene things.
How is that fun?
I don't know.
People?
I never just, understood that.
It's just now, baffling.
Now those same guys, like ourselves, they won't buy a ticket unless there's seating available in the
yeah,
mezzanine.
That is a deal breaker for me.
But it's those same guys
now.
It's those same guys now. Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Is that still happening at concerts? Are people still fighting over
who knows?
Which division of basically the same music?
Yeah, I think everybody realizes it's all showbiz at this point.
We like loud, heavy music, but your hair's longer, so we have to have a fight.
I don't know if anybody really buys that anymore, that whole tribal identity.
It's yet another extension of repressed homosexuality.
That too?
It is. Why else would you do that? What is wrong with you? Go suck a dick and feel better about yourself. That's better than getting in a fight with somebody. Go suck a dick. Get over it.
Can you spell that, please?
What?
Can you spell that, please?
I don't know what you're talking about.
He was referencing something from earlier today from... our chat conversation.
I'm blanking on it.
I don't think so. Try it with the D.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Got it. Sorry. Yeah.
I told you I was going to do it at some point.
Yeah. I wasn't with it. But now I remember. But seriously, the whole slam dancing, moshing and stuff, it's all repressed homosexuality spilling out of these guys. Why else would they be so angry and violent? It's because they can't accept something about themselves that they would like to make love to another man. Just do it already. Nobody cares about what you do sexually. Just get it out of your system. But certainly don't fucking take it out on me with your fists or anything like that.
Right.
Fuck you with that. Go suck a dick instead. Everybody will be happier, and yourself included. Just go do it.
You never had any... You never went to any shows where they had stuff like that going on?
Well, I mean, I...
Or you just didn't participate?
Well, I certainly didn't participate, but I didn't... It wasn't...
I'm talking about dick sucking. Okay.
Can't recall a show where that broke out, you're always on the verge of it happening in any of these mosh pit slam dance shows. You're always one step away from that.
Chris's editor made him take that description, that part out of his White Lion review back in college.
Yeah.
Saw that happening in the audience.
Yeah, they should have done it to each other on stage. It would have made it more interesting.
The legal guy called him into the office.
Well, that might have been the first time. It wouldn't have been the last. Yeah. Happened often at Playboy. When you get called into the legal counsel's office at Playboy, you know you've really pushed the envelope.
You know you are truly edgy.
Yeah.
Yeah, no shit. All right. So this is 87-ish?
I think it's 86.
Yeah, interesting. I mean, I knew that who the two Anthrax guys in the band were just from our discussions about it, but yeah. I'm kind of in the dark about it, but I'm interested based on the comparisons.
And just the name of the band, Stormtroopers of Death. Like, Stormtroopers, I'm thinking like Third Reich soldiers.
Yeah.
Like that, so they're probably going for...
Well, and the title of the album, Speak English or Die.
Speak English or Die, yeah. I mean, it's... It's provocative mm-hmm. all across the board.
Edgy stuff.
It's 85, excuse me. There you go. 1985. Are you guys ready?
Yeah. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention this. I'm not going to elaborate on it because it's we don't do that anymore in 2020. But there are theories about what the not stands for with anthrax. Told to me by someone who I... And going to take him at his word as somewhat in the know. He's from that area of the country. And that's all I'm going to say about it. I'm going to do that move where I bring something up and then I'm not going to elaborate on it.
But, the move that you hate, but...
Let's just say one of the letters in that word is N. Do the math on the rest of it. And that's all I'm going to say about it.
Oh, boy.
So, you know, factoring into what we've got going on here, who knows? But even if it's all true, they can just say they were acting. They were pretending, channeling people who would hold these beliefs. And why can't prove otherwise.
You know, why can't you say that about everything? Like, say you tweet something. Say you're a person of a public figure and you tweet something offensive and someone wants to quote-unquote cancel you. Can't you be like, I was playing a character?
Because they're not that smart, for one thing. Most, if you're talking about the public figures in the political realm, they're not that smart, for one thing.
Right.
And second of all, they just instantly turtle up and delete the tweet, and then hire some crisis PR firm to like cover their asses.
Thank you for holding me accountable.
Yeah, exactly. Well, all those, you know. The Fallons of the world, the Jimmy Kimmels, they get all defensive or worse, just wussified apologetics. Like, I was fucking playing a character.
That's exactly what it was.
My public persona. Isn't that what Stephen Colbert does? This is just my persona.
I haven't watched his show since he moved to CBS, but his old show was...
Yeah.
Like, I mean, a satirical character.
So why not just say that about everything?
Yeah.
Yeah, or like, you know, Tarantino and Pulp Fiction, the dead N-word storage sequence. How come he's not raked over the coals for even writing that dialogue?
That's
because he's playing a character.
But not only was he playing it, he played it, wrote it, directed it.
Yeah, and delivered
conceived
it with
every moment
and delivered
of
it with aplomb, so to speak. If I'm pronouncing that word right, but, you know, with gusto.
There you go.
Oh, but I was acting. I don't really have those beliefs.
Right.
It's like when Honey Bunny and the other guy are holding up that coffee shop.
Oh, yeah.
What do they do with the kitchen staff? Mexicans out of the kitchen. Is that really necessary? Where did that come from? What depths of your brain did that come from? I don't really pigeonhole Mexicans as kitchen staff in a coffee shop. I'm just acting. I'm a screenwriter. Oh, okay,
then you're fine. Here's some money.
Such horseshit. Double
go do
standard.
It again.
Right, exactly. But seriously, is that necessary to have that in there? No. You know, the character I was writing that for, he's the racist. Yeah, okay, QT, you got it, right. Thank you for explaining that. thank you for holding me accountable for assuming you're a racist.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Now, do you have a problem with that, or do you just think...
I don't have a problem with it, but when I'm sitting there watching it, same thing when I'm watching like Law and Order SVU.
Yeah.
Like, whoever wrote this is a sick motherfucker to come up with this stuff. Oh, I just read it in the headlines. Yeah, okay. Yeah, sure you did.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you read it in the headlines. You went and jerked off to it, and then you wrote the plot of a TV show. But no, you're just normal. You're a writer for a TV show. Yeah, okay. Whatever. Such bullshit. The double standard, you know. And then you think, you know, what happened to Priest and all those other bands around the time when this came out, fucking being taken to trial for contributing to somebody's suicide with a song.
Yeah.
Oh, they wrote it in a song, so they have to be Satanists. Fuck that. It's so stupid. Anyway, let's get to the music.
All right.
So Milk.
Milk.
Yeah, don't, no more, no explanations other than that. I just want to see if I can ascertain what the song is about other than the obvious and why a song would be written about milk.
I got the lyrics up because I think we're going to need them.
Yeah.
Okay. Without any further ado, let's enjoy a commercial.
I'm quite satisfied with the do I have.
Okay, good. Here we go. Whenever you're ready, computer.
Come on. This is pretty stock S.O.D.
But I just remembered something. I believe, someone could fact check me, this song might be credited with the first recorded blast beat that has gone completely
I've actually read stuff about that in recent, like Blabbermouth or Loudwire article where Benante has taken credit for that, which by all accounts he should, but people are getting in his grill about it that they don't think it's an accurate claim.
Okay.
See, and I always thought that, I guess not for everything, but didn't they switch off sometimes? Didn't Scott Ian play drums and Benante play guitar, or was that just on the live?
I think that was just on that live Anthrax, wasn't it?
I mean,
when they did I'm the Man, don't they switch?
Well,
or Joey plays drums.
They switched on the S.O.D. live.
Oh, really?
Also a little bit, yeah. That.
Okay. I think I'm assuming
this is Benante playing drums, though.
When I saw them, that was 99 when they did that reunion.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't do any switching at all.
No.
So I don't know.
You saw this band?
Yeah, at the Metro.
Oh, that must have been interesting.
It was.
What year was that?
99.
Oh, cool.
So they did this and a tour and then nothing until 99.
Four members?
Yeah, and then a second album and a tour. I think they toured for like 2 or 3 years around then.
Really?
Really trying to push it. I think they had nothing going on with Anthrax in late 90s, early 2000s.
That was probably the end of the Bush era, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, because then he came back and he did that Greater of Two Evils thing in like 03 or 04. I don't know. There's musical chairs for a while.
Yeah,
those,
they've kind of...
lead singer.
Anthrax has kind of become one of the bands where there's kind of a revolving door with certain...
Well, certainly the lead guitar slot.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that and the lead vocalist.
Well, but they've only had two lead vocalists. Well, the first guy who kicked out the guy who's playing bass in this band. But
yeah.
Did they ever record anything with that guy?
They had one album with the first guy. The first
thing, really?
Fistful of Metal is... I can't remember that dude's name. I'm going to have to look because it's bothering me. But yeah, first album is with him.
Did not know that.
Yeah.
Well, they had a couple of guys. They had, who's the guy that they recorded? They started recording worship music with, and then he got booted. And around that time, it was kind of like blabbermouth every day. There was some Anthrax drama regarding lead singers.
And then they had Corey Taylor signed up to be in Anthrax. And then,
really?
Yeah, I guess he was into it, and they were writing material together, and then somehow the plug got pulled.
Was that
it
before
happened.
Slipknot? Or?
No, during.
During?
Yeah.
Wow.
Wild
stuff.
Yeah.
Who knew all this shucking and jiving was happening?
So pretty typical stuff as far as the Anthrax album so far. Like a pretty big, like, it's all power chord riffs, basically. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't think of, obviously, every bit of music off the top of my head from the album, but the stuff that sticks out is it's power chord riffs.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's also, I mean, there's no other way to say it. The production is pretty terrible, and it's also both the bass and the guitar to me are completely lacking in mid-range. That's why when the drums kick in, they both disappear. It's just like white noise, pun intended. And it's just kind of a wall of noise once the drums kicked in full. So, I mean, I'm not stoked about the sound of it, but see what happens when the vocals kick in.
First singer was Neil Turbin. That's the name I couldn't think of. So, there you have it. Let's continue. Stop it there. A lot going on.
A lot to unpack, yeah.
This couldn't be more literal with the lyrics of this song. I woke up, can't wait to eat. Got my cereal, boy was I beat. Opened the fridge, and to my dismay, there was no milk. My mother will pay.
Okay.
Then I want some milk. My coffee grows cold. I want some milk. I should have been told.
I can actually relate to that. Is there anything worse than pouring yourself a bowl of cereal and you realize there's no milk?
Not if you're Andy. Like,
well, what does Andy do?
At one point, I was using water in my cereal.
Oh, that doesn't make any sense.
No, I never got it either, to be honest.
I mean,
you don't do it still?
No.
Okay.
I'm a full-blown milk person again.
Oh,
but there
good.
Was like a decade where I wasn't drinking
milk.
Well,
you simply... You don't eat the cereal. You pour it back in the box, which nobody wants to do. But
yeah,
you can't just pour water in there. It doesn't make any sense.
You guys remember that scene from Friday?
Yes. That's
exactly what happened with Ice Cube. He pours
vaguely
a bowl.
Remember
it's
it.
Exactly that. He pours a bowl of cereal and they have no milk. Then he gets into an argument with his dad. Possibly the all-time greatest comedic line delivered by John Witherspoon. We might have to visit
at
the end of this.
There are many.
Yeah.
Okay, I've seen the movie. I'm vaguely remembering that. But it's great, though, that Friday, this song, it's a totally relatable thing.
It is. It's
like
happened to everyone.
You assume there's milk there. Or even worse, like you start pouring the milk, you realize there isn't enough for this bowl. Then it's not an option to put the cereal back in the box.
No,
you're
going
screwed
back.
At that point.
Yeah.
And it does make you angry. And you want to blame somebody else.
Yeah, like your mother in this
Absolutely.
Case.
Absolutely. My mom will pay. Okay.
I should have been told.
Yeah. Yeah. I need to be I need the info here. I didn't get the memo about this.
Well, that's a learning experience.
No,
right?
I find this extremely relatable.
You look for the milk maybe first next time.
I guess so. This is how you learn.
Yeah, but
there are two ingredients
thing,
here.
Though.
You just pull them both out.
But that's
out
the thing.
Beforehand.
There are certain lessons in life that you somehow never learn. This is one of them. Seriously. Most people just assume the milk is there when they just pour out the cereal. I don't know if it's a morning thing and you don't have your wits about you, but this is a lesson people have learned the hard way and they continue to make that mistake. Extremely relatable.
What's in your mind as you're recalling this right now? What's the cereal in the bowl?
Well, my preferred cereal is Cinnamon Toast Crunch.
It's a good one, yeah. I think that's.
Are you trying to egg me on to another joke that I'm
missing?
No,
no. No, that's actually, you know, that's funny. I think you and my older brother have that in common, if I'm not mistaken.
The Cinnamon Toast Crunch. Cinnamon Toast Crunch is the secretariat of cereal. Back in the day, it was more of like a, what was the fucking, the Crunch Berries, that was it. And probably Lucky Charms, you know, something with a little... little nuggets of extra in there, but
and there's a perfect song to listen to along with while you're eating your Lucky Charms, which would be the Donald Isley song "Lucky Charm."
Oh yeah, well, it's a little more, you know, romantic, I think.
Well, it's early morning.
Yeah,
could be in that mood.
That's more of a lover's breakfast. The crepes, the fruit, the berries. Real berries, not the artificial shit that's in Crunch Berries. They even make Crunch Berries anymore?
Yeah,
they
do all kinds of Captain Crunch variants.
Well, see, that's not a necessarily good thing, messing with that formula.
But it's all over the place.
Yeah, that's a classic cereal. I mean, you wouldn't want to do away with it.
They have like a Christmas one where it's... whatever.
See that
red and green berries.
Once again, these are marketing people ensuring jobs for themselves coming up with this shit. It's like when you're in marketing for Coke. It's like, what else are you going to do with fucking Coke besides try and make sure that every human being on the planet is consuming Coca-Cola? I mean, what they're coming out with a Coke coffee.
Really?
Yeah, it just got double the caffeine of a normal can of Coke.
Oh, good.
It's coffee blended with Coke. It's like, so that's some brilliant marketing asshole came up with that, ensuring him of a big fat salary at Coca-Cola Enterprises or whatever they call it.
I wonder
it.
If that guy's job is like a lot of, they say CEOs, where they have to write, when they get hired on, they have to compose and submit their resignation. And it's just not...
when they start?
The board doesn't accept it until they need to accept your resignation.
Really?
I'd heard that, yeah. I don't know
just
how,
so they could push it out there when they want to throw you out?
Yeah, like, I don't know how common it is, but yeah, I've heard that that's a practice.
And that doesn't surprise me. It strikes me as those guys are like, you know, coaches or managers in sports. They're hired to be fired.
And then they get
the golden parachute and they move on. They fail upward and move on to another job.
Yeah.
So whoever
what happened at Playboy.
Whoever this Coke Coffee
you got
guy,
that right. Don't get me going on that shit.
That's where I learned about failing upward.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, wait, he came from Columbia House?
talk about a skill that everybody's... if you haven't mastered it yourself, you should make sure your children are able to master it. Failing upward. Yeah. Sadly, I've never grasped that.
Absolutely paradoxical, but it happens.
Legit,
but yeah.
Somehow.
Well, this Coke Coffee guy, I'm sure his resignation will be accepted shortly.
Well, you know, yeah, it's...
and it won't matter, because I'm sure there's a bonus... a parting bonus.
Right, and when he interviews at the next job, he'll be like, I came up with Coke Coffee. Oh, really? That's pretty interesting. Or like
sits down and says that.
Yeah.
Okay, sounds good.
When do I start? I came up with Coke Coffee, you know? Or like McDonald's, a marketing guy. Let's come up with a new sandwich and start the name with MC. Oh, okay. Excellent.
Yeah. Here's a six-figure bonus for this year.
Yep. We're going to take 6 months to hash this out, and at the end of the day, it's going to be Mick whatever the sandwich is. You know?
I mean, who can argue with the success, I guess?
McRib, McChicken. Right. Yeah.
Right. It's a pork chop sandwich. 6 months later, we're going to call it the McPork Chop. Perfect. Put it out to market. And then to McDonald's, the corporate chef at McDonald's. Get the fuck out of here with that. What are you coming up with, a chef?
That's going to be the sweetest gig in the world.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's a chef.
The expectations are
hell out of here.
Are well below your abilities.
Exactly. I mean, seriously, you have hit the Franklin Gibbs jackpot when you become the chef at McDonald's or Burger King. Get the hell out of here.
They don't...
So stupid. You know that comes with a fat fucking salary,
sure.
Like $500,000 a year.
I'm sure of it.
And then you get
to figure out how to make the hamburger patty even smaller. That's your job as a chef.
They look at the McRib. You don't need a chef. You need the guy who designs the Play-Doh molds for kids to play with.
That's true.
Anatomically correct ribs.
I've still never had a McRib.
You're not missing anything. And they're fucking tiny now, just like everything else. It's tiny. That's how they boost their revenues. They just make everything incrementally millimeters smaller from one eating season to the next. Whatever you want to call it. This shit is tiny now
that,
man.
That's now the gunslinger that we need that has passed on is Andy Rooney to call that out.
Mm-hmm.
Those coffee companies were probably trembling in fear whenever one of his reports were coming up.
But it's absolutely true. I mean,
yeah, it's just weird. And it's also now it's presented with like, we're doing it for you because you need portion control.
Right,
but that's the guise of like, well, this has too much sugar.
Well,
too much fat.
Now, whoever came up with
that,
that's marketing genius.
Yeah,
it's like there's
an
obesity problem. Right. Let's blame the customer.
Right,
and change the price.
Not
just make
it
smaller.
Well, but they change the price up.
Right. Not down.
Which is another way. It's like, you know, we're going to price you out of this because you shouldn't be eating as much.
I mean, at that point, it's a blatant middle finger in the face of the person buying it.
It kind of always has been, but it just gets worse from
the finger gets
from
bigger.
Eating season to eating season. Yeah.
It's a Pinocchio middle finger.
It is.
Every eating season it grows.
It's a good thing that we timed Pot of Thunder month to be in the middle of the peak of eating season.
Yeah, what would be peak eating season if not for this goddamn pandemic?
Yeah, no kidding.
I think we're on to something with this, but it's absolutely true. I mean, how do you boost your revenues?
You guys
put out a smaller quantity and you raise prices.
Mm-hmm.
Do you guys ever participate? You get together with your friends at somebody's house and do a draft for the eating off season, a fantasy draft.
I do no fantasy sports, be it football or eating. I don't participate. I do watch the hot dog eating contest every 4th of July without fail. Other than that, not interested.
Last year I traded McRib for a first round pick.
For the Hostess pie to see which one is smaller.
And I'm glad you brought up the Hostess pie, okay? Back when I was in middle school, that was the crown jewel of junk food because it was cheap, it was huge, and it was, you know, satisfying.
Yeah.
Now, in like the Hostess cupcakes and the Twinkies, if you somehow saved one from 30, 40 years ago and compared it, it would be about half the size nowadays.
It's like absolutely.
It's like a pierogi now.
And now, what are they, about like $2 each maybe?
Probably.
They're 35 cents back in the day.
Used to be a dollar, I mean, not even that long ago, a dollar, what, like 20 or something for the whole box?
Yeah.
Where you can get, what is it, 6 in a box or something? Things have changed.
Yeah, and not for the better, but, you know, that's just the old dickhead in me talking, which is kind of just me talking.
In general. I'm feeling you. I'm right there with you.
A lot of Hostess talk tonight. Right when I got, as soon as I got here, there was Hostess talk.
That's true. That's
before we recorded.
Something in the air.
Mm-hmm. Might have to have an orange cupcake while we do the Yardo questions. I've got some of those in the pantry today.
I don't know that I've ever had one of those.
I think
with
today's
the
your
swirly
day.
Line on the top.
Yep.
I don't know that I've ever indulged in an orange.
We're going to have one shortly.
That was a classic.
Awesome.
Used to come in like the dual container.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And like when the container was done, you'd hold it up to your chest like a fake set of brown tits. Nobody never didn't do that in school. You just go walking around the cafeteria with that. That never not happened in middle school when anybody got the cupcakes.
And I bet it got a laugh every time.
Absolutely.
Too.
Yeah.
Guaranteed. The crinkling sound when someone would sneak up behind you and grope you.
The plastic hostess tits were like a fart. Always funny. Never will not be funny.
I guess we have to get back to this.
Though. Cave drawings portraying this.
Yes.
I'm going to play this 7-second clip. I say arguably the most perfectly delivered line in the history of comedy by John Witherspoon.
Even though I don't fully recall it and I'm not fully ready meaning I don't already know what to expect.
Mm-hmm.
I'm convinced you're probably right because John Witherspoon is a master.
Yep. Here we go.
I'm throwing this away. I ain't even got no milk. You better put some water on that damn shit. All right, I eat it.
How can you top that? The delivery, his voice goes up.
That guy was all, he was delivery.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It didn't matter what he said.
Delivery and timing are all... if you got those two, you got... The world is your oyster.
I mean, honestly, his timing rivaled, like, Jack Benny's.
Anyone's,
like, people that are known throughout history for being masters of comedic timing.
But no, water in the cereal is not an option. Either
no.
Pour it back in the box or you dump it out in the trash. Just water in there, it's not happening. I would openly defy John Witherspoon in that situation. I would absolutely not do it.
All right, let's keep going here. Oh, wait, hold on. I'm going to turn this up a little bit. Go back a second or two. Okay. Charlie's peeling one off on that chorus.
He is.
My God. If you want that, what was it? I wish I had some goddamn milk. My Cheerios just ain't the same. I wish I had some goddamn milk. Too bad the milkman never came. I can't go out to the store. I'll just wait till my mother buys more. I'll just have wheat thins and beer. If I get sick, the toilet is near.
So he can't go to the store.
No.
Now I'm thinking this is from up to this point, I'm thinking this is the character that's singing this as a child. But then the wheat thins and beer come into play.
Yeah.
And dash that whole.
So it makes it even funnier that he's an adult who's mad at his mom.
I can't go to the
store. He's mad at his mom.
Why can't he go to the store?
Yeah,
this is an immature person.
Yeah. It's funny, though, because it doesn't
think.
It doesn't fit the quote-unquote character of
this guy's
the majority
of the
album.
I'm having a complete disconnect with all of that.
That's not
from
that song at all.
Just a cursory explanation of it.
Yeah, that's not happening on this
song. This is a guy who's content to cry over not spilled but absent milk. Basically.
Unavailable milk.
Yeah.
Milk supply that has been exhausted.
Zero problem-solving capabilities.
Well, which is the calling card of the loser. I can't go to the store. Why not?
You can.
What's holding you back?
Go to the store.
Are you physically unable to get to the store? And when you get to the store, you don't have any money to buy anything? What's at the root of the problem?
Hit the aluminum recycling plant on the way there. Do what you got to do.
I don't think he has that kind of time. The coffee's getting cold.
He sounds like he's got a lot of time.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
He's got nothing but time to solve problems. It doesn't cost any money to solve your problems.
All right. There's only a little bit more. 35 more
seconds.
I
was going to say, these are not long songs, I'm assuming.
I think the longest song is still under 3 minutes. That's the part I was singing, complete with the grunt leading into it. Into the
this and what was the part. Oh, into this part.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. There it is. There you have it.
Right.
That riff is reminding that, if you want to call it a chorus riff, it's
part?
Reminding me of a Suicide Machine song, I think.
A DDT, maybe?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I hear it. Never made that connection, but I hear it now. How about that? Okay. So there you go. Milk. What the hell? I'm looking at this. This is the, what is this called? Whatever, 30th anniversary edition. So there's a bunch of Milk live in Tokyo.
Of course. Do you guys ever, has there ever been a re-release like that that you guys have legitimately been like, you listen to the extras more than once?
Yeah, but very few.
Yeah.
A lot of them are bad.
A lot of them are yeah, it's not even really
like demos
worth doing. Yeah. It's cool to hear, but it's just one time you're going to listen to it. Yeah.
Yeah. There's a couple Faith No More albums where they did like the larger deluxe editions. And they're one of those bands where they had a handful of songs that were recorded at the complete, you know, like complete quality of the album,
mm-hmm.
fully produced. And then those were on it and they're good. So.
And they weren't like B-sides of singles?
They were, but oh, okay. You know, you'd have to find them.
Yeah.
Like a, whatever, well, a Japanese B-side for a single or something.
See, that I'm usually on board with. If it's a collection of B-sides or something, it tacked on the end. But live stuff, usually when they throw that on the end, it's pretty underwhelming.
And God forbid, you hear Motley Crue demos. I forgot which album that was on, but...
I've never heard a Motley Crue demo in my life, actually.
I couldn't believe it. I'm like, how is... The laziest demos I've ever heard. Like, these turned into hits somehow. Bob Rock really heard something in these demos.
I'm curious now.
Maybe it's just to get the idea down. You can't really criticize it, but it's just, like...
Yeah.
Very underwhelming to hear.
And it's... It just goes to show you what wonders a producer can work. Mm-hmm. And it also... You know, gives you some insight as to why some certain songs made the album and why others didn't. It's because they were not up to par. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And that decision was made by usually somebody outside of the band, because though band guys want to just put everything out there, and it's not always the right thing to do. And then, you know, you come in with your song and it gets rearranged, restructured by the producer, and you know, if you're a pro, you go along with it because they're usually right.
Yeah.
You know, if you're gonna dig your heels in about your art, get the fuck out. Let the next idiot in line take your place. Otherwise, do what you're told.
I wish someone would do that with us.
I think every band should wish that they got to that level where somebody said, well, there's something here, but you need to do this, that. Maybe have that guy play the bass instead of your actual bass player. He can be on the album and do the tours, but he's not good enough to play on this studio recording.
Right. We don't have time for him
to
fumble then, through these songs.
And then you're okay with it because you see the bigger picture, but otherwise, you know, you're some jackass off the street who's gonna, you know, hold firm because of your art. Get out.
Jack, these bedroom dickheads and their art.
Oh, they don't even get to that level because nobody can hear any nuggets of quality in anything they do. Motley Crue demos sound like Sergeant Pepper compared to what these guys are putting out. fucking Robin Ford wannabe blues tunes. Get out. Just don't put that out publicly. Do yourself and everybody else a favor. Do not put that out for the world to consume. Unless a toilet is near, in fact.
All right. So it's time to vote. Sweet Surrender or Kick in the Crotch, since I chose this song through our friend Joe Patterson, who submitted it onto our list.
On the first poll, no less.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's ever happened for Mandy.
I don't think so. And I made a prediction that I was going to go all three rounds and pick the last one regardless.
That's a tough prediction. No. I'm going to make a prediction that the sun's going to come up tomorrow.
Well, apparently it's
on
not.
Those lines. Well, one day that'll be true.
Yeah, today was the day that this was finally true.
This was a first round knockout upset.
Yeah. Couldn't say no. So I'm giving it a sweet surrender. I'm voting first. Give it to me.
It's sweet surrender. Hell yes.
Mm. Lot to say about S.O.D. Specifically, not just Milk, but a lot of these songs from the first album, and I'd say from the Live at Budokan. I think those albums, I don't know what the percentage would be, but are responsible for forming part of my sense of humor, which is weird. You know.
Now, was this cassette one that you had? We had that portable tape player, and you had your bike with the basket in the front, and you would drive. You would ride your bike around,
yeah,
with tapes playing. I remember, and Justice for All was one of them.
The Garage
Days, the original one.
Yeah. Alice in Chains Dirt was
one for some reason. And this was one.
And this
right?
was one. Yeah. So there you go.
So if you heard Andy cruising around,
yep. I was ahead of the curve with having mobile music.
while
riding my bike. But yeah, big fan of S.O.D. I get why maybe some people don't see something in them. If that's, you know, if you're looking for,
I don't think I've ever heard anybody say that though. Well, I think everybody gets it.
Yeah,
or
you
most
think so?
People get it. That it's yeah,
they know what they're coming for.
Yeah,
yeah. It's not Queen or whatever.
No, and it's not trying to be. And
yeah,
but, and why if you're doing this and you're more or less the originator of this. There have been a lot of bands that Andy and I were in a band that was pretty similar.
It was like identical.
And kind of quickly evolved that way. Didn't start out that way, I don't think, but
yeah.
I mean, if you're the forerunners of this kind of thing, then I mean, creatively it's something new at the time.
Yeah, definitely. So, who wants to go next?
I'll go next since I've been jawing a little bit. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give it a sweet surrender as well.
It's sweet surrender! Hell yes!
Now, that being said, this is not one of my favorite songs off of the first album.
Mm-hmm.
How many albums do they have out?
I want to say three. There was Bigger Than the Devil was the tour that I went to in 99. And then, no, that's it. Because then Rise of the Infidels is like a live album or something. Oh, okay. I forgot what it is.
So was the Metro sold out for that show? Or?
Yeah. It was crazy. It was a crazy show. I think I talked about that at one point on here, that I would have been 16. And I'm not especially big now, but I was a slight boy, like 140 pounds or something. And I just remember there was like these bruisers were out there beating the shit out of each other. And I'm like, okay, I'm going in the upper deck for this. This is, you know, these guys are like 230, 240, and they're throwing punches
and
elbows.
Yeah.
And they'll kill me if I'm down there. This isn't just like one of those shows where the crowd's kind of swaying and bumping into each other.
It was out for blood.
And then I wonder what happened afterwards, Chris.
Oh, they all sashayed over to Halsted Street, which isn't far away, and they indulged themselves. And then they felt dirty about it afterwards, so they just went to the next punk show and beat the shit out of each other again.
Yeah.
And the cycle continues.
Yeah.
until they become comfortable with their own gayness.
That can only end in an American Beauty ending, unfortunately.
Exactly.
All right. Chris's turn.
I just want to say that I like what the band is about. It's very entertaining. I think it was somewhat groundbreaking, and I would go. I mean, like United Forces, Milano Mosh,
yeah,
March of the S.O.D. That kind of stuff. Those are my more go-to songs off the album.
Mm-hmm. I'm a big Kill Yourself fan. Great one.
Yeah.
Chromatic Death is cool. Not lyrically, obviously, but cool song. There's a really good song. I think maybe, arguably, their best song. It's not off the classic album, but Kill the Assholes off of Bigger Than the Devil is great.
Hmm.
So I'll have to check that one out.
I like the title of that.
Yeah.
I will say, lyrically, I'm a huge fan of the line, "I should have been told." I'm going to be incorporating that into my professional life.
Yeah.
Whenever something slips by me, either through my own fault or somebody else's, I'm dropping that at work next week. I should have been told.
That seems to go with, from the Gerardo episode, the "This I Will Not Try."
Yeah. I like that kind of thing.
It's a couple of phrases that can become regulars.
Yeah, plus a couple times it's happened to me this week at work where suddenly, you know, I get this instant message. It's like, are you gonna join this meeting? I'm like, I didn't know I was supposed to be in a meeting.
I should have been told.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I guarantee you that will happen again probably early next week. So I'm using I should have been told.
As you should.
That said, I'm kicking this one in the crotch.
It's a humiliating kick in the crotch!
I just, this kind of music has just never been my bag. I just don't detect any differentiation between the occasional examples of this genre that I hear. I can't tell the difference between one or the other. And it's just, it's not well produced, which maybe is intentional or just a sign of the times. If that's what they were going for, great. But it's not a pleasant listen for me.
Mm-hmm.
And just that kind of breakneck tempo and stuff is just, there's nothing appealing about it to me, really. Never really was. So
to me, it's always been novelty. I mean, there are serious great grooves and riffs on this album.
Mm-hmm.
But when it goes into the, you know, the blast beats and stuff, that's pure novelty at that point for me.
Not into it, huh?
Well, no, I mean, from that perspective, I'm into it.
Okay.
But not something that I think it goes into the absurd, in my opinion.
Okay. Well,
so does 80% of modern metal go into that.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny.
Yeah. Well, if anybody disagrees with our voting, we're sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
But not that there's anything wrong with novelty. I mean, what do they call a drumstick ice cream cone? That's a novelty. who's upset about that?
Well, a chin dildo would be an adult novelty.
Is anybody mad about that?
No, it's certainly not the
recipient.
Have
you ever seen a guy in a pit wearing one of those?
Yeah, well, if not, they should. They should.
Running at each other like some kind of weird rhino.
Like a joust.
See, that should have been happening all along. I mean, that would make sense of it all if that was the case.
Two guys get on shoulders of larger men, run at each other with chin dildos.
The end game is the single motion mouth plunge. When you've done that, you've won the mosh pit.
There have been horrific nostril related injuries. Yeah.
Pants stripped off, and again, do the math on the rest of it. But if you can, with a single plunge into an orifice, you've won.
There's a knighting process that goes on afterwards. That ceremony.
See, that would make it would all make sense then, and it would be a totally legitimate thing. And it, that two takeaways from this episode. There should be such a thing as an eating season.
Yes.
And chin dildos should be mandatory equipment for mosh pits from here on out.
Yeah. I'm with you. I don't even know what's happening in music as far as...
There's nothing.
Well, nothing, but yeah. I just mean in the last decade or whatever as far as what kind of crowd interaction even exists anymore, if mosh pits are still a thing.
I think everybody's just on some sort of substance. It's gone back to the 60s where you're just there and you're like... You're on some sort of enhancement. Some
but they weren't beating the shit out of each other.
No, but I mean...
They were doing these weird hippie dances. And
I think that's what it is now.
Nick Saban went back to that. People are beating the
shit
out of
each other. But not this scene.
No.
I think it's some sort of foreign substance is necessary these days.
Yeah, I mean, at the big festivals. Yeah. There's all the talk of Molly or whatever the fuck it is. Everybody's on drugs. Which, whatever. And it's not... entirely different from how things used to be, but no. It's just further proof that we don't, guys our age, certainly guys my age, we don't belong in those places.
No.
Stay home.
It's over with.
It is over with. And, and if you show up at these things, you're a fucking loser. Stay home.
You know, when I go to those things, I just go right to the food truck area and hang out there.
Yeah,
most of the time.
Get me a funnel cake.
Yeah, and that's fine. That's that. But, you know, don't get in the mix. Yeah. Some old asshole. You should get decked immediately.
See,
and then kicked and pommeled when you're on the ground. Teach you a lesson.
Spit on.
Exactly. See, urinated on, defecated on, the whole schmear, as they say.
I could be wrong. But I feel like whenever you see videos from more recent times where it's some kind of metal performance or hardcore or whatever, the audience does still move around. But I feel like it's mostly older people who are like, I'm not getting hurt. I gotta get up tomorrow. I can't go to the hospital.
I mean, come on.
It's not the same violence that it used to be. Like the 80s, no. I wasn't there. But from what I understand, hardcore shows in the 80s was...
Well,
like legitimate violence.
Well, absolutely. And you witnessed it when you saw S.O.D. Metro.
But even that seemed like...
But that was more gang violence back in the 80s, I think.
It was
faction violence.
Like watch a Bad Brains clip from CBGB. I mean, these guys are launching themselves into each other, and it's just absolute mayhem. And yeah, you know, it's... You wonder how more people weren't dragged out in stretchers or even in body bags for that stuff.
Yeah, and then you had the breed of bands that would antagonize. They would antagonize the crowd.
Well, right.
Fear.
Fear being the kings of that. Yes.
And then, but
and
then
Black
you have
Flag.
Yeah,
Black
Flag. But you have like a legitimate skinhead faction going on. I mean, you know, they're just people like that are just looking for trouble.
Yeah.
They gravitate to this stuff.
That's in that... Henry Rollins' book that he put out, where it was his old tour diaries, Get in the Van. It's like basically
I've wanted that book since the mid-90s and still haven't gotten it.
It's, I mean, who knows how much he embellished, if he did or didn't. I don't know.
There's always some embellishment. Let's just get that straight right now. Not saying that it wasn't a hardcore scene to the max, but every story is embellished over the years by everyone.
The only thing, his claim with that book is that it's legitimately his diary that he was never going to release. And then he's like, you know what? I'm just going to put this out.
Well, right. But as he's writing the diary, whether he knows it or not, he's embellishing.
Yeah. That's what I think. But just reading that, it's like, you know, I'm going to make up one of these entries. It'll be like, you know, played in Berlin, Nazis showed up, put cigarettes out on me, fist fight, broken nose, like everything. Every show is like that at those things. Guy hit the guitar player in the head with a bottle, had to get stitches.
It's kind of like The Dirt, where it's like, could these guys have survived?
That's what I
think. All this is absolute truth.
Yeah. It's just seems where it's like people show up and they want to hurt someone. You know, and that's it. Yeah. That's the only purpose. They don't even care about the bands or anything.
It doesn't make any sense.
And then there's just a fight between everyone.
It's very bizarre.
Yeah. I would like to be a fly on the wall for something like that to see if it really was as intense as people say, but I would not like to be part of that scene.
No.
That's, I'm glad I missed that.
There's a self-destruction kind of thing. You see the old, like even like old Sex Pistols era stuff, you see the crowds and there's a overwhelming air of the desire for self-destruction in the audience.
Yeah. Can't relate to that.
No.
I just want to eat some orange cupcakes and enjoy my night.
Yeah, where are those at? At a certain age, you just kind of, you have to smarten up, I think.
Yeah. If you're going to make it through a, you know,
yeah,
a certain point.
I mean, at a certain age, anything can give you months of pain. Anything. Wow.
Yeah, like
much less going in a pit.
Right.
Well, and again,
but taking out the garbage, you could be injured.
I hurt my knee for several months because I turned slightly odd coming down a step.
Yeah, and it's, you know, if you're anywhere above the age of 25 and you're getting in a mosh pit nowadays, I'll say it again: you deserve to take one across the jaw that sends you to the ground, at which time you should be kicked, pummeled, pissed on, and shit on. So hopefully you learn your lesson. Get out. It's not for you. Old people at concerts, and yes, when you hit 25, you're old to be at a concert. Stop showing up. Watch it on TV. Stay home.
I hope our next commercial breaks on Nugenics one. Yeah. About you're still young. You just need more testosterone. Get back out there and do what you always did.
All right. Who wants an orange cupcake?
I don't know if I can... See, there's another example of the age. It's
you need to look at the clock. Chris just looked at the time.
I do.
He's like, what is he? He's a mogwai?
First of all, I shouldn't have needed to look at the clock. It's after dark. To eat an orange cupcake at this juncture would be devastating. I'm curious to look at it and see the size of it compared to what I remember from the past. But I might be embellishing the size of the Hostess cupcake from the back.
That's
of the
true.
Day.
Could be. All right, I'll be right back.
Sing away.
Oh, look at that.
Yes, Chief.
So we are going to do a yard of questions.
And if you have one, then we'll have a yard of cupcakes. So this is the part of the show. Oh, what happened to me? This is the part of the show where we take some listener questions. You can submit yours at potofthunder.com. Just go to that URL, and then once you're there, look for Yardo questions to submit. Ask us anything, as long as you ask three different things, preferably. We don't want to answer the same question thrice.
That would be interesting, though.
That would be. You can give a different answer each time. And Andy's back, so I can stop pretending like I can MC something.
Yeah, thanks for filling it.
You can't carry a show. Neither can I. Yeah,
thanks.
He's a fucking tiny. Look at that. I mean, come on. Like again, you couldn't if these came in the dual plastic thing. You couldn't even do the fake tit gag with these things. I mean, this is ridiculous. Look at that. Look at that thing. That's pathetic. That is not a large orange.
That is tiny. That is tiny.
I mean, seriously, now. That's a joke.
I'm going to eat one, but...
Yeah, as you should.
You want me to throw one to you?
Yeah, please.
I'm not going
Oh, man.
Even these tiny cupcakes would wreck me at this juncture of the day.
All right. Well... This week's Yardo questions. I didn't even look at it. I just looked at the name.
Oh,
I'm going to go with this one.
Okay.
I haven't even opened the email yet, but I see who it's from, and we can't go wrong.
Okay.
It's from Signed Gorshin.
Oh, nice.
Okay. An old school fan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That story's from years ago.
We can't go wrong with Signed Gorshin.
Framed and tacked up on the wall in my man cave.
Still, huh?
Yeah.
That's good.
Procured by the Punch It guy, one of Andy's favorite people.
That guy's awesome.
See, there's a perfect example. He's just like the singer of S.O.D. He's like, you know, we need a singer. Our friend Scott here, he's not doing anything. Come sing for the band. And he's actually pretty good at it.
Mm-hmm.
We did that with two of our other friends back in college, and they were pretty good at it too. But there was that last bit of self-application and dedicating themselves to the craft that ultimately held them back. But
yeah.
But that's something else I find relatable about SOD.
Yeah.
We need a singer. This guy's got some charisma.
Let's do it.
Give it a shot. Maybe you'll get better at it.
Yeah.
It ends up happening.
All right. What do you think of that orange cupcake?
That was good. Man? I liked it.
It's gone already.
It's gone already.
Well, Nick's not playing around.
We're talking about how small it is.
And then on the front, by the artwork, did you notice this? Product enlarged to show detail. It's like, why is it? What legal imbroglio led to that having to be put on the fucking cover?
There was a class action lawsuit.
I mean, again, having worked in the corporate world, probably took him 6 months to come up with the wording for that little disclaimer on the front. What a joke.
Okay. Sorry, I was wolfing down my bite. Question.
Forget it. I was going to ask a cupcake question. I don't really want to know the answer. Go ahead.
Question one. What is Pot of Thunder's official corporate response to COVID-19? Wow, that seems appropriate.
I have no idea. What would a corporate response be, necessarily?
I don't know, but every website you go on, regardless of what it is, has some banner that comes across the top with their COVID response. Or what. It's I just want to order something from your website. I don't care how you feel about this or what precautions you're taking. Just send me my shit.
Aren't all those... don't all those basically say we're trying to keep everybody safe?
Well, yeah, right? They all say the same thing.
It's the same thing. It's pointless.
Bullshit.
So what's ours then?
We say nothing. It's like the company I work for in my day job. Some of my coworkers are hot about it, but we've said nothing about either COVID-19 or Black Lives Matter or any of that.
Well,
and you know what?
Does it apply to what you're
doing? It can, because, you know, the mortgage industry, the redlining and the depriving people of equal opportunity and whatnot. But at the same time, people are like Andy. I just want to get a low rate on my mortgage and I want it done quickly. Mm-hmm. I don't care whether your employees are sitting 6 feet apart. Who cares?
Right. I don't get it.
So we're clearly, you know, at the first opportunity, we reconvened here in the studio. I mean, there was eight weeks we did remote.
It was probably about eight. That was long.
So what is our corporate statement? We cared up to a certain point.
We just followed what the governor said. We didn't.
Well, I know there were also, there were family concerns. You know, sure. You guys have the kids. We all have... older relatives that we have to be cognizant of, but you know, at the end of the day, here's the corporate statement: come out with a fucking vaccine so we can at least have some semblance of real normalcy again.
Yeah,
it's weird. God, I mean, nothing's gonna be back to normal until that happens, and even when it does, it's, you know, then you're gonna have the vaccine debate, so we have that to look forward to.
That's already going on.
Well, I know, but it's gonna get fucking ridiculous when they actually come out with it.
But you know what, if you just don't go on Twitter and don't watch the news, you'll be fine.
No, it's true.
Just don't get sucked into that negative toilet. No, waiting in the toilet, right, as we said last
week.
But
it's easy to get brought into that, but you can take control and insulate yourself from that, absolutely.
But it's a nightmare to hear these people.
Well, it's nobody knows what they're talking about, period. Well, and nobody's interested in anybody else has to say about it, so just stop talking about it.
And I think I can sum up everything.
Okay.
Please do. I would love to.
It may
hear
not
it.
Be a perfectly concise statement, but I think I think I have a grasp on it. Mm-hmm. And it goes with what Andy said. If you don't allow yourself to be sucked into everything that's being put out there, then you'll probably be okay. Everybody that you see on television on Twitter, anybody trending social media, those people, any videos of stuff that's gone down at any sort of gathering of humanity, those people are caricatures. They're extreme caricatures.
Mm-hmm.
And there aren't, thankfully, I don't think there are that many of them, really.
Unfortunately, they seem to be shaping the world.
But yeah, well, there's that. But you can take comfort in the fact that, really, these people are extreme caricatures.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Are you saying image enlarged to show texture?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, they're like the crying baby. Eventually, you can't ignore it anymore, and you have to pay attention to it. But you know, they're just crying out for attention, and they're motivated to do that. It's like all they think about doing. It's like, what about just keeping your mouth shut and living your life, not dumping everything about your whole existence out on social media?
Every time I see that, all I think to myself is,
how dare him?
Yeah.
How dare him?
Yeah,
it's been a while.
Yeah. Jussie Smollett is loving this because it's taken the attention off of him. But, you know, it's
doing backflips along with Ron. Him and Rahm Emanuel get together on a Zoom meeting and do backflips.
You want to talk about local. Rahm Emanuel and whoever the previous governor,
Bruce Rauner.
Every day dropping to their knees, thanking the Lord that they didn't get reelected and have to deal with this bullshit.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nightmare. Absolute nightmare dealing with this. How do you sleep at night? Constant barrage of stuff that you need to do. Then you pile on this nonsense that happened in Minneapolis and elsewhere. It's just a fucking
Portland.
Unbelievable bullshit going on.
You know, one more nugget of bullshit regarding COVID-19 response. I mean, it's sort of like what we were saying earlier about how hostess pies are smaller for your safety, basically. It seems like in certain cases, businesses are getting lazy and then blaming it on COVID. Like, oh yeah, we only have one entrance open, which is the opposite of what would be better for keeping distance from people.
Mm-hmm.
It's like we have three entrances. We've only got one door working because of COVID-19. What does that even mean? It doesn't make any sense.
Well, I think everybody's confused about everything right now.
It's ridiculous.
And I think that's why a lot of people are angry.
Right, because nobody's stepping up to be a leader and give reputable, reliable information about anything.
Yeah.
Everything that's coming at you has an agenda behind it. Make no mistake about that.
Mm-hmm.
And either nobody knows the truth, or for some reason, they're holding out on it. But that's a whole other story.
Yeah. For some reason, we'd be yapping for the next 3 hours.
Yeah. I just bought a new washing machine. I got it today. A couple days ago.
They sent you your shit, basically?
Yeah, thankfully. But I had to go to like 4 different stores because every store was out of washing machines. So it went from being, which washing machine do we want and like how much do we want to spend to, do you have a washing machine we can have? And the reason, the COVID thing.
Like, that's I ordered a dishwasher.
Well, and that's
month and a half. It's taking.
But that's happening. It's happening to me. It's happening to my neighbors. It's like everybody you look around at everybody's doing this home improvement stuff because you're home all the time and you're noticing all this shit that needs to be taken care of.
That's true.
And then you're running your dishwasher and your clothes washer way more frequently than you ever did before because you're home all the time.
Yeah, yeah. That was the other part of it. There's no one who can do any kind of service call at this point
because
everything is broken that everyone has apparently at the same time because, like you said, they're running it nonstop.
Use. Yeah.
So that was, we can come in, it was 15 days when they told me they could come look at my washing machine. I'm like, I'll just find one.
It's not going to cut it. Can you imagine going back to a laundromat at this stage?
Not happening.
That is subhuman behavior, in my opinion.
I would throw my clothes out and buy new clothes for 15
too.
Days.
I think back when I had to go to the laundromat, and it's just like, you know, the clothes washers and dryers, absolute must.
Can you even go now, since there's a U.S. coin shortage, which is the sign you see at every restaurant you go to? Coin shortage, pay an exact change or credit.
Or die.
Yeah.
Or just, you know, you can't round down, so no. They'll round it up for you, and that's that. But
ridiculous.
Yeah, it's all horseshit.
All right, we're going to do a 180 here with question two. How do you want your steak? Just a nice, quick, fun question.
I'm definitely a medium guy. Because most of the time when you order in a restaurant, they'll undercook it. So in case you just want it refired, they can do that. Mm. If they overcook it, it's fucked. So usually when I order medium, I get a medium rare. And I can deal with that. I'm fine with that. I prefer it on the closer to the medium. So I always order medium. And if it's slightly undercooked, I'll just have a refire. But it's usually it's fine.
Medium well, I would say.
And Nick eats steak, right? Sometimes?
Sometimes.
Nick's not a beef man.
I'm more of a pork chop guy.
Yeah.
But
how do you take your pork chops?
About that way.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not undercooked pork is not advisable.
No,
honestly,
no. But I mean, yeah, you can get it a little pinkish, and
yeah,
it's still,
I mean,
somewhat
you
safe.
You don't want to lose all of the savoriness of it, if you will. But yeah, it was until I got to college before I ate any meat that wasn't well done. My mom cooked the shit out of everything.
Yeah.
You want to talk about tiny hamburger patties? I mean, I didn't know, you know, how the other half lived until I got to college. And we went out to this place, Mountain Jack's, near the campus, and we all went out for steak dinner. Where we got the money for that, I don't know. But yeah. Yeah, it came around to me, and I said, how do you want your steak done? Well done. And even before the waitress could say anything, the other guys at the table were like, center away, and they're like, he's going to rethink that, just come back in a minute. And they asked me why I was ordering it. It's just like, that's how I've always had it. They said, try medium or medium rare, see what you think. And it was like a revelation for me. I don't know, some weird Spain, Europe thing that they cook the shit out of everything, but that's just how it was.
Our mom did, too. I'm not being negative about
it. I preferred it that way for a long time.
Yeah. I think my mom was more concerned about any kind of bacteria. Killing all bacteria.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe she'll defend
Kill
herself.
All the bacteria was her favorite S.O.D. song.
Yeah, it was. All right, question three. What are your thoughts on adults dating coworkers? Question. A little slap and tickle between two teenagers slinging pies at Little Caesars. Ah, what's the worst that can happen? But I'm talking a man and a woman with careers here. Your advice would be appreciated.
It's
usually a terrible idea.
And it's nauseating for your coworkers. Because everybody knows.
You're right. Yeah, exactly. You think you're doing it on the sly. You're not. and it's just, it's not going to end well. There's no way it can possibly end well.
I mean.
And that unequivocal no to that. I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, the differentiator is how he was specific about older people, you know, career people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, back in when I worked in the college newspaper, we were all banging each other, you know, because we were in college. That's what you do.
It was like a hardcore mosh pit back
then. It was. And, except not nearly as gay. It was much, much more heterosexual activity happening. Same when I worked at the Hard Rock. That's where I met my wife. But you know, when you're younger and you're working in kind of these high-stress situations, there's kind of that bonding that happens. But, you know, once you start to get settled into a career, it's a terrible idea.
So we're telling Cyan Gorshin no on that.
Because, absolutely not.
Because I'm assuming it's a man.
Since it's Cyan Gorshin, it's a perfect time to drop the classic pun about this situation. You don't dip your pen in the company ink. Just don't do it.
There you go. Yeah, I can't imagine that turning out. I mean, there's what is the slim chance where you end up happily ever after with each other in a corporate setting? It seems, I mean, sure it happens, but
it's probably about the same percentage as high school sweethearts being married.
Well, but even that, you're even thinking too long term about that. It's just like most people just think they can have a fling at work and it's not going to end badly, yeah. Or there's not going to be any weirdness, or there's not going to be any out of balance feelings going one way or the other. You just think, oh, I'm going to bang the hot chick at work for a few weeks and then it's going to be over with, and we're just both going to get on with our lives. It's not going to happen, ever.
Especially if you have to interact with each other. Well, assuming on the company size or whatever it is.
Right,
but yeah.
But
if you have any kind of interaction with this person on a regular basis, don't do it.
And if you don't, how are you going to meet the person? Yeah, of course you're interacting with the person.
That's true.
Otherwise, you don't even know they fucking exist. Seriously, work at a huge corporation. You work in a 6 billion buildings over. How do you even know they exist?
Christmas party, I don't know. But that's,
you take notice of somebody you encounter every day.
Yeah.
And,
so, bad idea.
Terrible idea.
We're stamping it as bad idea.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah, just think of the times you've been mad at your significant other and then gone to work and kind of forgot about it. You don't get to forget about it if you were at work with that person. And it probably amplifies in a work setting because there's these angry feelings that you can't really discuss in the open, but you're interacting in a group.
Plus, who has time for that? I mean, every job and every workforce is designed to get the maximum out of you for the entire time you're at work. How do you work in a sex session?
What do you mean, at work?
Yeah.
Like, this is during hours?
I don't know. I mean, that's what I assume.
Yeah, I didn't think of it that way. It could be.
But even so, it's like after work. It's like, I want to be done with work. I want to be done with the people at work.
Yeah.
There's other hot males and females out there, whichever your preference is.
Yeah.
Go out and find somebody else.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just that makes no sense.
It's bad. All right. And to end the show this week,
uh-oh,
we got an email from a listener.
Oh, jeez.
And this goes back a couple weeks ago when Blind Lemon Jefferson was mentioned. The blues is alive and well. Did you guys know that All Night by Kiss is a cover of a recently rediscovered country blues song by Crippled Kiwi Fillmore? Let's see. It was recorded before Blind Lemon Jefferson became famous. Legend has it that Blind Lemon got the idea for his stage name from Crippled Kiwi Fillmore by combining a physical ailment, a fruit, and the last name of a U.S. president.
Okay, this is an individual who has way too much time on their hands.
He says, rock on, guys. And this is from our friend, Jeff Spriggs, all the way up in Winnipeg.
Another pegger.
Another pegger.
Yeah.
All right, so
they're all pegging each other up there.
It's one big mosh pit up there in the Great White North. All right, well, let's play this out, and then we'll be done. We're gonna go out with this.
Okay, I don't know what it is.
Well, he sent in a blues song that he sang.
Oh, I missed that.
All Night.
I missed that part.
Was okay. A blues
from
song.
The '20s.
From the '20s.
Woo!
So here we go. Thank you.
5 for deep. Prison starts at 8:45. It takes a hard-working lover to keep on towing the line. I'll meet you under the covers. I get excited. I'm so excited when the work all day. Show ya. I get excited. I'm so excited when we work all day. Don't know why. It's just one thing that money can't buy. When your body's been starved, your appetite. When you work all day, you gotta work all night. Oh, baby, let me hear ya.